Welcome to the conference, Theorizing Consent, Educational and Legal Perspectives on Campus Rape. There are a few areas pertaining to modern higher education that have received more media attention and even legislative concern than the phenomenon of sexual assault on or surrounding college campuses. A much publicized study by the American Association of Universities, based on data from multiple public and private universities, reported that 23% of female undergraduates nationwide had faced some form of sexual misconduct during their years in college. One frequently hears the figure 1 in 5 or 1 in 4. Concerns about campus safety are nothing new. In response to the brutal murder of college student Jean Cleary, Congress passed a bill in 1990 which has since come to be known as the Cleary Act. This requires colleges that receive federal funding to publish annually statistics concerning crimes that have occurred on their campus. Since as part of its effort to recruit and retain students, every institution wanted to appear safe, student affairs administrators were in many cases tempted to manipulate the statistics in their favor, particularly when it came to those crimes that might be somewhat ambiguous or depend entirely on a victim's testimony. Sexual assault has, of course, always been one of the offenses where skepticism on the part of law enforcement and juries has been strongest. By systematically denying rape claims on the part of students, trying to convince complainants that they were somehow responsible for what happened to them, or that no one would believe them, these student affairs administrators were perpetuating an age-old tradition of rape denial that had been the target of feminist activism since the 1970s. Several years ago, a number of rape survivors and student activists, with support from some feminist NGOs, challenged the systemic rape denial on the part of university administrations by filing Title IX lawsuits in federal court, claiming that rape was a form of sexual discrimination and that universities' inattention to the problem created a hostile environment that denied female students equal access to education. Laura Dunn, who will be speaking to us tomorrow morning, was one of these student activists, and the history of this movement was depicted in the documentary film The Hunting Ground, aired on CNN late in 2015. Let me add that this university was not among those sued, and on the whole has done a good job dealing with this issue, and we'll be hearing from some of our administrators tomorrow. However, it is well known to those of us who are longtime faculty that university administrators often have a hard time admitting that they were ever wrong about anything. And systems of accountability for administrative dishonesty or incompetence are weak or non-existent. This is particularly true at private institutions, which are not subject to open records law. And even at public universities, it is routine for the legal staff to use phony claims of FERPA privilege or ongoing administrative deliberation to evade scrutiny. Too many administrators regard their first loyalty as an obligation to support fellow administrators, rather than to do what is in the long-term interest of the institution, its board of trustees, public, or principles of broader professional ethics. Unfortunately, well-publicized lawsuits with the right of discovery and powers of subpoena are sometimes the only tool available to bring administrative arrogance to heel. Believe me, I know from personal experience. In response to the success of many of these Title IX lawsuits against institutions that had ignored or covered up incidents of sexual assault, the Office for Civil Rights of the Department of Education sent a letter on April 4th, 2011, to all institutions of higher education that receive federal funding. This is now known as the Dear Colleague Letter, after its generic opening salutation. This letter was an administrative interpretation of the requirements of Title IX law as it had evolved through the judicial decisions in response to the wave of recent litigation. Among its most prominent and controversial mandates were that colleges must use a preponderance of evidence standard in adjudicating cases of sexual assault, In other words, if there is a 51% probability that a sexual assault had occurred, the incident was to be so classified and disciplinary sanctions needed to be invoked against the perpetrator. The Dear Colleague letter also required that institutions not allow the defendant in a sexual assault investigation to cross-examine the complainant on the ground that any contact between the defendant and complainant might perpetuate a hostile environment that would abridge the complainant's right to equal educational access. As a result, universities were required to adopt an inquisitorial model of adjudication in which all questions would be asked only by university administrators in a secret setting, with the defendant having no guarantee of access to transcripts of the evidence used against him or her. Many civil libertarians are deeply disturbed by the patent unfairness of such procedures, which appear to violate fundamental Fifth and Sixth Amendment privileges. In defense of the inquisitorial model, others have argued that university tribunals are not criminal courts and are not obligated to observe constitutional protections when making decisions about which students to exclude from the university. We will hear some of this debate from our speakers tomorrow. However, we should not be unaware of the irony that the very same administrative personnel who were in many cases previously guilty of covering up incidents of sexual assault on campus are now put in charge as the grand inquisitors with sole discretionary power to determine whether questions will be asked, which evidence will be considered, and what constitutes a 51% probability of guilt. Historians have not judged the Spanish Inquisition very favorably. Nor is any inquisitorial model one that is likely to create just results. Grave concerns are accumulating that the pendulum has now swung to the opposite extreme, with university administrations expelling or suspending male students who are later proven through electronic records or third-party witness testimony to have been completely innocent. This exculpatory evidence was either not available to the university tribunals or not sought by them. Not only have universities added compliance personnel and engaged expensive law firms to provide training in implementing the OCR's new interpretation of Title IX mandates, but university administrators have become increasingly alarmed by the prospect of being sued in turn by these male defendants who have been suspended or expelled after allegations of sexual misconduct that were not fully or properly investigated by the institution's Title IX compliance officers. Such cases have been brought against well-respected institutions, including Amherst College and the University of Southern California. Per a California Court of Appeal on April 5th ruled against the university. A more recent case involving fully consensual conduct at Colorado State University Puebla has even triggered litigation not only against the university, but also the Office for Civil Rights for having created an interpretation of Title IX that itself encourages male gender bias and violation of due process right. University leaders feel caught between Scylla and Charybdis on this issue, in danger of being sued by both sides. One female president of a prestigious liberal arts college, whom I've known for many years, recently told me of her discomfort with seeing her institution enmeshed in such close regulation of student sexual conduct, based on what she considered to be largely overblown media accounts of the ubiquity of sexual assault. The fate of the administrative regulations surrounding Title IX will depend on the results of the next presidential election. In a Clinton administration, we will likely see them maintained or even expanded. In a Trump administration, we might not. However, the activism surrounding the issue of campus rape is not limited to Title IX interpretation and the ever-metastasizing definition of what constitutes a hostile environment. On the state level, both California and New York have passed laws requiring a strict standard of affirmative verbal consent at every stage of lovemaking that involves students at a public university. The Campus Accountability and Safety Act, now pending in Congress, promises to do the same on a national level. It enjoys bipartisan support and little organized opposition. The prestigious American Law Institute, which provides the model penal code on which many state legislatures rely in drafting state law, is currently considering an affirmative consent standard, not only for application to college students, but to the general population. Professor Kimberly Frazon, who advises the panel of the ALI considering the sexual assault provisions of the model penal code, will tell us more about this tomorrow. Of course, Canada already has such provisions in its criminal law, and we have two speakers from Canada here at the conference. Despite the language of the Canadian statute, activists in Canada have expressed disappointment over the willingness of police and prosecutors to enforce it. In any case, where enforcement becomes sporadic or discretionary, it tends also to become arbitrary and discriminatory. The William A. Percy Foundation, which is one of the co-sponsors of this conference, has done research showing that statutory rape laws tend to be enforced in ways that discriminate heavily against same-sex relationships, both in terms of willingness to prosecute a complaint and in terms of prison sentences for those convicted. In this rapidly evolving area of legislation and jurisprudence, it is imperative that we deliberate very carefully about the long-term consequences before leaping ahead in a willy-nilly rush to do something about the perceived problem of campus rape. That is the goal of this interdisciplinary conference. Our keynote speaker this evening is someone who is familiar with issues of sexual politics and the dangers of overly intrusive legal regulation of sexuality. Laura Kipnis is professor of radio, television, and film at Northwestern University. She's a well-known video artist and author whose work has appeared in Slate, Harper's, Playboy, and the New York Times. In reading her work, I have usually found that she has something original and altogether sensible to say that nevertheless hardly anyone else seems to be saying it. Openly. Her recent article on consensual relationships between students and faculty in the Chronicle of Higher Education resulted in her becoming the subject of an expensive and drawn-out Title IX investigation by her university, from which she was eventually exonerated. Among her provocative books are Against Love, A Polemic, 2003, How to Become a Scandal, Adventures in Bad Behavior, 2010, and Men, Notes from an Ongoing Investigation from last year. And her next book will carry the same title as this talk, namely Stupid Sex, Higher Education. The Title IX investigation of Professor Kipnis was cited among other recent incidents in a draft report issued on March 24th by the Venerable American Association of University Professors, the AAUP, titled The History, Uses, and Abuses of Title IX. The draft report raises serious concerns about the threats to academic freedom, faculty governance, and due process that have stemmed from university responses to the OCR's Dear Colleague letter of April 2011. Concerns have grown among many educators that open discussion of difficult and controversial topics like rape may itself become the subject of Title IX litigation on the grounds that it is distressing to some students and therefore creates a hostile environment. This conference, in its entirety, is an emphatic rebuke to those who say that rape is too traumatic a subject to be taught or debated openly in a university setting. We will be hearing from educators who have made it a focus of their teaching and research and who, from their multidisciplinary perspectives, have much to contribute to a careful consideration of where public policy should be headed. We shall hear different points of view tonight and tomorrow, hopefully find some common ground, and more clearly delineate where we still have areas of disagreement. Even after teaching a seminar on rape this semester, I do not think I'm smart enough to know answers, but I look forward to learning more that can help both my students and me wrestle with the profound ethical and legal dilemmas that this subject poses. So with that said, let's turn to our first speaker, Laura Kipnis, and welcome her with a warm show of Texas applause. I think we do need the mic because we're video recording.
But is this mic so that you can also hear me better? Yes. Okay. Good. Hi. Thanks so much for the invitation. I'm really looking forward to this. I hope I get out alive. I think that there are going to be a lot of different viewpoints, and I see from having read the abstracts and the point coming in. So I'm just going to launch it, and I hope that I don't replicate too much of what Tom has already said, but here I go. After students on my campus staged a protest march against an essay I'd written in the Chronicle of Higher Education about the new climate of sexual paranoia in academia, I wrote a second essay in which I said, somewhat jokingly, that I quickly realized all my writer friends were jealous that I'd gotten marched on, and they hadn't. And I noticed myself shamelessly dropping it into conversation whenever possible. Oh, students are marching against this thing I wrote, I grimace in response to anyone's, how are you? I was trying to take a lighthearted tone. I'd written the second essay, as Tom mentioned, after getting brought up on Title IX complaints by two graduate students, not my own students, I should say, over the first essay. One of their charges was that I created a hostile environment on campus, or maybe it was a chilling effect. I wasn't entirely sure which, because I never actually got the charges in writing, which led me to become interested in questions I'd never thought much about, like academic freedom, which I'd always taken for granted, and due process, another thing I'd never thought much about. The issue of sexual consent, our subject here, also came to my attention. Indeed, I eventually started to think it was at the heart of things. And of course, the booths. I ultimately came to think that it wasn't entirely impossible that in a convoluted and indirect way, like a butterfly flapping its wings in China causing a hurricane in rural Illinois, that I got brought up on Title IX complaints because of the booze problem. Not my booze problem, I'm talking about students. I never much cared whether my students spent their weekends binge drinking and barfing into bushes, as long as they got to class on time, and I don't usually teach Mondays. But when it comes to campus sexual culture and its afflictions, you can't help noticing that there's a strictly enforced cone of silence around the drinking problem. And cone of silence is a polite way of saying dishonesty, especially as it pertains to women and the variety of not great sexual experiences that get collapsed under the omnibus and, to my mind, problematic term, rape culture. I'd like to propose the term stupid sex instead going forward. As Tom said, the title of a book that I've just finished. Unless that is, we're talking about situations involving physical force, and mostly we're not. Statistics gatherers and rape activists themselves say that physical force isn't the prevailing issue. The issue is consent. And the largely futile attempts by campuses and the DOE, or the behest of the DOE, to adjudicate stupid sex by narrowing the conception of consent, among other short-sighted and oversweeping measures, has created a very capacious regulatory net I myself got snared in. The solution to ineffectual regulations, more ineffectual regulations, to the point that one can now get brought up on Title IX complaints for writing an essay. In my own case, getting hauled through the Title IX process wasn't the worst thing in the world, mainly because I have tenure at a research university. Also, I got a bunch of speaking invites. Here I am. And not least, a massively interesting subject more or less dropped in my lap about which I just finished a book. How could I not write a book given what I now know? And I know a lot, because going public about my case put me on the receiving end of dozens and dozens of letters and documents related to other people's Title IX cases. My inbox became a clearinghouse for depressing and infuriating tales of overblown charges, secret tribunals, capricious verdicts, and frightening bureaucratic excess. A lot of what I learned was shocking, and I'm not exactly unjaded about institutional power. I don't think it's an overstatement to say that there's a secret war being waged against the professoriate, which no one knows much about because it's all shrouded in demands for confidentiality, gag orders, that is, enforced with threats about more charges if accused professors go public. I myself was threatened with more charges of retaliation if I spoke. I decided to take the risk, but anyone non-tenured or on renewable contracts, and this includes grad students, is in a different boat. And of course, the largest at-risk population is male undergrads, many of whom are being turned into human sacrifices on the bonfires of bureaucratic overreach. Where to start? Who to blame? The simple answer is, of course, the DOE and the Office of Civil Rights, which in 2011, as you've heard, expanded Title IX's mandate beyond gender discrimination to incorporate sexual misconduct. I won't say more about the Dear Colleague letters, and also demanding the campuses use the lowest standard of proof, preponderance of evidence. So long to niceties like presumption of innocence, hello to the campus's penal colony. How is that feather of preponderance arrived at? In too many cases that I've learned about through a combination of guesswork, gender stereotypes, and expediency. And about which I think that there's a fatal lack of oversight. And I am aware there are probably some Title IX officers here in the audience, and I'm sure those are the good Title IX officers, but I mean, the cases that I've heard about from around the country are really pretty frightening. And my sense from all of these people writing to me who have no other recourse, I mean, I'm getting asked for legal advice, I'm getting asked for advice on what to do on these people's cases, and I'm hardly an expert, is that Title IX officers are more or less making up codes and expanding codes on the fly, and there's absolutely no oversight. So that's the simple answer. A more complicated answer about who's to blame is that the culture of sexual paranoia I'd written about isn't confined to the sexual sphere. It's fundamentally altered the intellectual climate in higher education to the point that ideas are construed as threats, and freedoms most of us used to take for granted are being whittled away or disappearing altogether. It's worth pointing out that paranoia, sexual or otherwise, is a formula for intellectual rigidity. And its inroads on campus are effectively dumbing down the place to the extent that the traditional ideal of the university, a refuge for complexity, a setting for the free exchange of ideas, is getting buried under an avalanche of fear and accusation. Why? The big story, to begin with, is that sex is dangerous again. For my generation, coming of age in the aftermath of the sexual revolution and related social upheavals, slogans like pleasure and liberation were the ones that got tossed around a lot. But campus culture has moved on, and the slogans now are all about sexual assault and other encroachments. Stop rape culture, no means no. Whether or not college students are actually having sex differently from generations past, and despite the supposed license of hookup culture, shifting the stress from pleasure to danger not only changes the prevailing narrative, it changes the way sex is experienced. We're social creatures, after all, and narrative is how we make sense of the world. If the prevailing story is that sex is dangerous, sex is going to feel threatening more of the time, and everything associated with sex will feel threatening, as we see in the sorts of charges being brought, which now include such offenses as making the wrong eye contact, literally. If sex feels dangerous, then even eye contact can feel like a violation. A risqué remark feels like an assault, even when not aimed at you. Tom mentioned third-party complaints, and that's a lot of what's going on. Other people's sexuality becomes encroaching, if not disgusting. A few years ago, I was having a conversation with a class about a movie. I believe it was The Opposite of Sex. I teach film. A student, a female, made a comment assailing the female lead's poor sexual choices. She got pregnant unintentionally. The student pronouncing a bit Cotton Matherishly, I thought, about the character's irresponsibility and sexual risk-taking, a judgment with which most of the class concurred. my students are all making films and writing screenplays, and the consensus startled me. First, because I spent a lot of energy trying to get students to get that moralizing about characters isn't a great way to go about writing interesting ones. Second, because we all knew that some percentage of the class, or their peers anyway, were making similar sexual choices not infrequently, which is why Plan B birth control is available on demand at the Student Health Service. So their condemnations just seemed a little hypocritical. Everyone lies about sex, I suppose, but I've come to think that each generation lies about sex differently. I don't tend to preach about such things to my students, though I did say, just to offer another angle, gosh, I feel sorry for you guys. When I was in school, we thought about sex in terms of pleasure. Your generation seems to think about it all in terms of risk. Another student, male, exclaimed, well, yeah, sex can kill you. I've thought about that remark a lot since. It was a great lesson in the obvious, which is that this generation of students is also the first post-AIDS generation. God knows what horrors they've been exposed to in their sex ed classes. Necessarily, I suppose, but still. Obviously, there's nothing new about a youthful education in the hazards of sex. And I recall disgusting slideshows about syphilitic sex organs in my own junior high school sex ed class, as each aging generation is all too pleased to educate the next one in the standard perils, pregnancy, disease, shame, spiritual corruption, and so on. The danger of sex is a recurring cultural script, to be sure. Crucially, it shapes gender roles and colors how gender is lived. Women are, after all, situated differently than men when it comes to sexual danger. Though, according to social science research, we typically also feel ourselves to be more vulnerable to sexual danger than we are. And I can think of no better way to subjugate women than to convince us all that sexual assault is around every corner. Still, for my generation of women, coming of age, post-pill, post-sexual revolution, and after second wave feminism had made at least a few provisional inroads into female shame and double standard, sex wasn't exactly uncomplicated, but even when it was bad, as it often was, there was hardly quite the same death knell tolling in the background. We didn't think of sex as a harm. That wasn't our narrative. Just to be clear, I'm not trying to say that my generation's story about pleasure was any more true than this one's story about danger. There's no singularly true way of thinking about sex. The truth of sex has been different at every point in history. Every era believes its own sexual narrative to be the truth of sex. And at this point in time, the dominant narrative, on campuses anyway, is all about hazard. The shift in sexual culture over the last decade or so isn't confined to sex alone. It's more like a land grab, gobbling up vast swaths of real estate along the way, including the very definition of what it is to be a woman. When it comes to sexual culture, each generation builds itself as an improvement over the last. No doubt the slogans about pleasure and liberation were our little lies about sex. The realities were obviously a lot more complicated, especially for women. But today's hazard story also comes with its own evasions, namely a large blind spot when it comes to female agency. In a sexual culture that emphasizes female violation and endangerment, i.e. rape culture, men's power is taken as a given instead of interrogated. Male sexuality is by definition predatory, women are by definition prey. Men need to be policed, women need to be protected. Regulators are thus justified in weaving an ever-expanding host of regulation. Among the weirder features of current campus life is a generation of student activists demanding greater regulation over their lives from the administration. More codes, less freedom. In contrast to the demands of previous generations of activists that campus officials get out of their lives, like the Berkeley free speech movement. When I was in school, the old people in charge of things weren't in cahoots with our sexual narrative, which at least provided something bracing to rebel against, an antithesis, some contestation. Now, old people and young ones, at least the more vocal among the young, all share the same proprieties. One argument against the sexual endangerment story is that it complements the political agenda of those running the place. Neoliberalism is a term heard a lot lately, meaning the corporatization of the university and the incredible bloating of the administrative ranks. Of course, Title IX compliance is among the central reasons for the bloat. The staffing up in the sexual misconduct area has been enormous. The ratio of administrators to students has nearly doubled since 1975, while the ratio of faculty to students has stayed constant. One thing not much said in the flurry of cliches about campus leftism run amok on Fox News or wherever is that expanding the reach of campus codes into micro-behaviors like eye contact is also a neat way for administrators to consolidate their fiefdoms. If my sense of humor or gaze falls under the jurisdiction of some associate dean, that's a net gain for him or her, right? These administrative hires are seizing the prerogative to set the tenor of the plays, and it's a decidedly anti-intellectual tenor, including demanding intellectual conformity on matters that should be open for debate among the community. I say this having recently been forced to complete a 123-question online course on preventing sexual misconduct and sex discrimination, geared to an eighth grade level, and in which no dissent from prescribed answers was possible. The edict to complete the course came from the same Title IX officer who wrote to inform me that I had been up on Title IX complaints. The notion of the victimized student has been a useful pretext for an enormous transfer of power over our lives to institutions and employers. Rights can be suspended because students are in danger. Resources can be diverted from education to administration because students are in danger. Female students, of course, despite the gender-neutral language. All of this is being put over in the name of feminism, or at least it comes wrapped in a vaguely feminist veneer. If this is what passes for feminism, then feminism is broken. What we're seeing is hard-won rights, for instance, the right for women to be treated as consenting adults in erotic manners, being relinquished without a peep, traded away for the pleasures of blame and pipe dreams of, quote, safety. Here's an example, one of many, of how this plays out on campus. And as I said, I was the one that got, I'm like a central clearinghouse for examples about things that I think don't generally get known until they hit the courts. So this was a case on my campus about who consented to what, resulting in a male undergrad being excluded, that's the new term, or euphemism. For 2 years from the university after being accused by his ex-girlfriend of sexual assault. What she meant was that she performed oral sex on him, that a month later decided, after he'd broken up with her, that she hadn't consented to it. There was no force. They'd been in an exclusive relationship for several months. He admits he pleaded for oral sex, but when he realized that she wasn't into it, he apologized and she stopped. Sometime later, one of the women's sorority sisters physically attacked the male student in a football game, accusing him of being a sexual assault perpetrator. When he tried to report the incident to a faculty advisor, he was told that if he pressed a charge, the university would investigate him for the underlying sexual assault. According to the male student's father, a professor at another university who related this to me, at the hearing, the student was treated as guilty from the start, couldn't ask questions of his accuser, and had 10 minutes to speak. The panel judging his case included staff members from food services and the environmental safety office. Campus officials are effectively redefining the meaning of consent with no public discussion about the implications, abridging the distinctions between ambivalent sex, sex you may later wish you hadn't had, and involuntary sex. The vague and unenforceable premise of affirmative consent means, in effect, that retroactively withdrawn consent is now permissible. In other words, rewriting history. Do we get to press charges against a former bedmate because we later feel regrets about what happened? Or we're drunkenly amorous and now feel stupid? Or later get dumped, as sometimes happens in college relationships? In my view, feminism can't be the pretext for absolving women of responsibility for their own decisions, because that would mean turning women into children. And that's not feminism. It's a return to the paternalism that actual feminists spent the last couple of centuries trying to overturn. Some have argued that the dominant versions of feminism on campus have themselves ceded to the same neoliberal imperatives driving the greater campus political economy. Carceral feminism is one term that's been used, coined by the feminist sociologist Elizabeth Bernstein, and carceral refers to prisons. to describe the diverting of resources toward policing and punishment as opposed to, say, education. Critics of the carceral turn are cynical about the role mainstream feminism has played in pushing a crime-focused mindset and a punitive agenda where, as Bernstein puts it, this is a quote from her, the crime victim has supplanted the rights-bearing citizen as the idealized legal subject of our time. My own term for all of this would be penal tolerant feminism, with all of the Kafkaesque implications. How is it that the most reactionary versions of feminism are the ones enjoying the greatest success on campuses? Of course, it's long been true of mainstream American feminism that the most supposedly radical fractions have been quasi-conservatives, dedicated to recycling the most conventional versions of feminine virtue and delicacy. And I'm speaking mostly of the Dworkin and McKinnon wing in the anti-porn movement, which did ally itself with the Christian right during the 1980s, as we're recalling. But another reason for the rush to justice, or frontier justice, however you want to describe it, taking hold on campus, is the belief, a mistaken belief, that accusers always tell the truth. There are many reasons to oppose this idea, among them that it sentimentalizes female victimhood while demonizing accused men. For some leading feminists, whether male students or faculty accused of sexual misconduct get fair hearings is simply beside the point. As activist and commentator Zerlina Maxwell put it in a 2014 Washington Post commentary, and if you haven't heard of her, there's actually a photo of her on her website sitting next to President Obama on Air Force One. So this is somebody who has the president's ear. So she wrote, quote, in the Washington Post, quote, we should believe, as a matter of default, what an accuser says. Ultimately, the cost of wrongly disbelieving a survivor far outweigh the cost of calling someone a rapist. Someone out there is raping 1 in 5 American women, Maxwell writes. And by the way, the timing of this is notable because it was immediately in the immediate aftermath of the University of Virginia Rolling Stone story being found to be a false accusation. So she wrote, and yes, it could be someone you know and love. It could be the boy at the frat party. Not to be a pedant, but let's recall that the infamous 1 in 5 stat refers to all unwanted sex conduct, not sexual contact, not rape alone, which includes unwelcome touching at a party. Thus, when Maxwell concludes that we shouldn't waste time questioning survivor stories because, quote, the FBI reports that only 2 to 8% of rape allegations turn out to be false, end of her quote, she's entered statistical neverland. Not only are rape and sexual assault being conflated, but even if the stat is real, is an 8% false accusation rate really acceptable collateral damage in student cases? Because in fact, the actual rate is probably higher. Emily Offen reports in Slate that 72% of insurance payouts in campus sexual assault cases over a 5-year period made by the leading higher education insurance group went to falsely accused male students. This was some $36 million in settlements. Still, it's an article of faith that if women make false rape accusations, it's actually less than 2% of the time. You hear this number constantly. So constantly that no one bothers to ask where it came from. Until a legal scholar named Edward Greer published a rather gripping statistical whodunit. I mean, I never thought a statistic whodunit would be gripping, but it was, in 2000, about his efforts to track down the source of that 2% stat. His first discovery was that every citation over a 25-year period ultimately led back to Susan Brown Miller's classic 1975 book, Against Our Will, Men, Women, and Rape. Yet Brown Miller's endnotes provided a rather obscure source for the figure, a speech by a New York State appellate judge in 1974. Greer contacts Brown Miller. Where did this information about the judge's speech come from, he asked her. Brown Miller cooperatively combs through her decades-old files and sends Greer a copy of the judge's Xerox speech. The speech cites the commander of a New York City rape analysis squad as having determined that about 2% of all rapes and related sex charges are false. To make a long story short, and I mean this really is like a wild goose chase that he chases every lead down, Greer eventually finds a New York Times Magazine article from 40 years ago about this police squad, which it turns out was composed of cops with no statistical training who simply collected data on false accusations in one precinct in New York. None of this would matter if fly-by-night statistics like this one, and of course the much miscited one in Five-Step, weren't the stated rationale for so much of campus and indeed federal policy, including justifying the preponderance standard in sexual misconduct cases. Greer himself thinks as many as a quarter of men charged with criminal rape might be innocent, but he also points out that such wrongful convictions off campus fall disproportionately on young black men. These stats are also wielded on campus to tell us and tell us and tell us that we're living in emergency times. Thus, all draconian tactics are justified. It's the Patriot Act transported to campus with rapists in place of terrorists, or alleged rapists, or male students caught in webs of unprovable allegations and tried in secret extrajudicial campus hearings. Sex has always been messy, which is what's both appealing and distressing about it. But compounding the messiness on campus now is the dismal fact that there's a long list of things you're not supposed to say about this mess. It's far more impossible to have an intellectually honest discussion about sex on campus on an American campus than off these days, which is nothing short of bizarre for anyone who was drawn to academia in the first place, because talking about difficult ideas and unpopular viewpoints was supposedly what went on there. The student case I mentioned above actually didn't involve drinking, though according to one especially honest campus official in a doctoral dissertation that I read, this is somebody on the Penn campus, in 99% of sexual assault cases that come across her desk, both parties were, as she put it, stinking drunk. Drinking is the subject you're not supposed to talk about if you don't want to get shouted down or accused of slut-shaming or victim-blaming. I've actually spent a lot of time over the last year talking informally to students, mostly on my campus and on a few other campuses, about these issues. And the more students I talked to, the more I came to think that the style of drinking in fashion on campuses is a symptom in the most classic sense, that is simultaneously masking and enacting a conflict. It's not just that kids are binge drinking and having bad sex. The forms of bad sex are more specific and more complicated. If there's a typical pattern I sense when it comes to heterosexual sex, it's college-age men and women getting bombed out of their minds and acting out stereotypical gender extremes. Men as aggressors, as predators, women as passive, as objects. Since what's more passive than a woman in a drunken stupor or passed out altogether? Too many of our women students, often I suspect schooled by us that gender is a social construction, take that to mean matching guys shot for shot and drinking rituals that parody equality, then having sex they didn't exactly want to have because beer pong doesn't differentiate for body mass. Alcohol is an intensifier. It intensifies acting out. Increased male aggressivity when drinking is inarguably a factor in the sexual assault problem. As one of my male students told me, guys like to drink because what you do when you're drunk isn't really you. You don't have to take responsibility for it. It was the booze, not me. And of course, the more alcohol you drunk, the more into you girls seem, he acknowledged. And what about the other side of the gender divide? Is it possible that it's not men alone for whom gender progress has been a little superficial? Drinking may be a way of shedding sexual inhibitions, but if we can't also talk about the ways that drinking increases tendencies for stereotypical female behavior too, namely female passivity, then we're being gender hypocrites. Binge drinking is a great way of inducing amnesia, and the main item forgotten by men and women both is the last 50 or so years of progress toward female autonomy. Gender progress, for all its pluses, comes with a certain level of inhibition. And if such inhibitions are among the first shed by drunken students, can we ask whether the chance to enact regressive gender stereotypes is among the motives rather than the unintended consequences for getting plastered out of your board? People use alcohol in all sorts of ways, and it's easy to disparage them. Consider the perpetual sneer that accompanies all the critiques of escapism or irresponsibility. But a yearning for freedom, however impossible it is to attain, probably tops the list of why people, including women, sometimes drink an imprudent amount. As anyone with even a meager iota of self-honesty knows, one of the great pleasures of drinking, possibly one of the fundamental reasons to drink in the first place, is being introduced to a version of yourself who does things you'd never do when sober and enjoys them, at least at the time. Yet among the new regulations administrators have been foisted on campuses is criminalizing sex when either party's been drinking. Pretty much all sex, in other words. Whoever invented that one seems either unacquainted with human sociality as typically conducted in the Western Hemisphere, or rather too eager to exponentially expand the potential criminal class on campus. In my forays into the sex assault prevention lit, one of the things I learned is that there are deep ideological schisms among the experts. On the one side are the harm reductionists who want to educate potential victims about how to decrease their chances of victimhood, using a buddy system at parties, not falling asleep with male study partners, and so on. On the other side of the schism are the primary preventionists who believe in targeting potential offenders while promoting overall cultural change. In short, harm reductionists want to aim educational efforts at women, preventionists want to aim them at men. The preventionists almost totally dominate the educational field. Why do preventionists think educating women on avoiding assault is the wrong approach? Because, in the words of a typical expert, quote, considered in a broader societal context, focusing on self-defense places responsibility on the victim to defuse an attack rather than on society as a whole to prevent it. To the preventionist, risk reduction strategies are victim blaming. Quote, why should the onus be on women to stop predators? This is the quote. The issue is really about men, says one. Society needs to establish a zero tolerance for sexual violence. Instead of saying, don't get raped, which shifts the responsibility onto a potential victim, the message should be, don't rape, and focus on holding perpetrators accountable. End of quote. One notices uneasily that the resulting campus policies manage to precisely replicate the supposedly passe social idea that men have agency and women are people things just happen to. Our policies are reproducing the most distressingly paternalistic notions about womanhood. In fact, there's growing evidence that these risk reduction programs targeting women decrease the likelihood of being assaulted by as much as 50%, the New York Times reports. Women with self-defense and assertiveness training are far more able to stop or subdue a sexual aggressor, both physically and psychologically able to than those without training. They're better able to set boundaries in sexual situations with men as well, suggesting an overall increase in their sense of agency. So why aren't such programs adopted everywhere? Because risk reduction programs contravene the getting men to change agenda, which dominates the assault prevention field. What strikes me in reading this literature, and I've read a lot of it, is how little focus there is, oddly enough, on women themselves. There's zero attention to women's relation to men, or even on what women want from sexual situations with them. We hear a lot about sexual assault in athletes, for example. Yet what we don't hear is any honest discussion about what women think they get out of proximity to athletes, or any frank calculations of how much abjection it's worth. Nor is female drinking open for discussion. A researcher studying campus assault calls it the, quote, third rail of the discourse, something no one wants to go near. And by the way, if you're a researcher in this area and give presentations at the Justice Department, you have to take the word alcohol out of your presentation title. You can't point out that being drunk makes women more vulnerable to assault. Drinking can only be discussed in the context of wellness. Oh, those mandatory sexual assault prevention programs all colleges must now implement, they've had absolutely zero effect on reducing the amount of sexual assault. According to all the research, and this includes a recent meta-analysis of 69 different empirical studies, levels of sexual assault have been constant since reporting was mandated by the Clery Act in 1992. Their minimal success has been no deterrent to continuing such programs, which seems simultaneously well-meaning and cold-blooded. The reason for this stunning lack of success, I believe, is that they're run by people dedicated to reproducing the social idea that men have agency and women are people things happen to. And unfortunately, this isn't exactly wrong. In the context of hookup culture, women are less able than ever to say no lately. They don't know how to, they don't think they're allowed to. You have the cultural and self-imposed expectations of sexual hotness, for one thing. You have the reigning versions of student feminism, which are a hodgepodge of gender progress and gender conventionality. Demands for female sexual equity on the one hand, i.e. fucking and drinking like the guys, extremes of sexual paranoia and injury on the other. In other words, it's one large mess. Yet young women still yearn to have adventures and make mistakes. Sexual adventurism is still the main envoy for freedom we've got. Not just for women, obviously. Something in all of us yearns to be free, even if it often takes a lot of alcohol to get even partway there. But there's a recent tendency, and I think this is unfortunate, to want other people to pay for those mistakes, namely the guys. Where this becomes catastrophic is that campus administrators and the DOE are ratifying this responsibility offloading into a blossoming compendium of codes designating men as the responsible parties in heterosexual sexual encounters where, for instance, both people are drunk. Technically, it's whoever advances the action, but in heterosexual reality, that mainly means the guys. This is a weird and short-sighted policy, a backdoor return to the most traditional conceptions of female sexuality. Somewhere along the way, a decision got made that women aren't agents, aren't co-responsible parties in sexual transactions. Women don't drink, men get them drunk. Women don't have sex, sex is done to them. What dim-witted sort of feminism desires to position women as children or shelter women from the richness of their own mistakes and ambivalences? And speaking now as a teacher, how do such protections prepare students to deal with the sexual messiness and boorish badlands of life post-graduation, where code-wheeling bureaucrats aren't on standby? My point is this. Heterosexual arrangements are a pact that include men and women both. Male and female desires, male and female pathology. Gender is a system. Male aggression and female passivity are both social pathologies that are, to varying degrees, normalized. Changing any element, including reducing female passivity, will alter the dynamics of the system. Yes, aggressively disposed men forcing sex on passively inclined women is normalized in our culture. But if women can't be taught to protect themselves against such normalcy because men should stop assaulting women and because learning to defend yourself would be capitulation to rape culture, well, here you begin to see the two-way nature of this social pathology. When I spoke to women students, I heard various stories about guys who won't take no for an answer, with varying degrees of pressure and unpleasantness. A typical experience related by one of my students, saying no a few times to a guy she was hanging out with, being pressed with a lot of why nots, and finally just giving in. She didn't describe it as an assault, although statistics collectors would. She wasn't traumatized, she said. She chalked it up to inexperience and being a freshman, though it's still an uncomfortable memory. Why is a no not a no? I was reminded talking to students about how much sentimentality governs these situations, or let's call it heterosexual sentimentality. It's not that women want to or choose to be assaulted, obviously, or choose to have stupid sex, to use my terminology. Too often it's that they trust their male friends and dates and former hookups aren't going to assault them or take advantage of them. Likewise, men don't seem to believe that their female friends or potential hookups or past hookups aren't going to sexually refuse them. They trust that the no's, when there is one, and often there's not, isn't meant seriously. It goes without saying that men have to learn to stop forcing sexual situations. But the reality is that the mistaken identity operates in both directions, which will no doubt proceed into adult life and govern future relations as well, but that's another story. So let's say you wanted to ask a question like this one. Why is it that at a time when the possibilities for gender equality are more robust than they've ever been, not without some pushback, but still, when the constraints on women are the fewest they've ever been, not to say absent, but still, women's sexual agency is still so iffy. Meanwhile, a new generation of student activists are joining arms with campus administrators to make more regulations that will do absolutely nothing to increase female agency. No one, least of all me, is saying that many of the assault charges brought forward are justified. There is sexual assault. There is harassment. The problem is that there's virtually no education for women on how to prevent or contend with these sexual realities. And these realities include their own ambivalences in sexual situations, because men are the ones who have to change. I was raised female in this culture and am thus on intimate terms with passivity. I've had the usual range of female experiences and sexual assaults, which is why I feel pretty strongly that feminists have to call out the codes of self-martyring femininity permeating such tales and the covert veneration of female passivity enshrined in our new campus policies and initiatives. Yes, there's an excess of masculine power in the world, and women have to be educated to contest it in real time instead of waiting around for men to reach some new state of heightened consciousness. Because what if they don't? What's also alarming about this cocktail of sexual hysteria and regulatory zeal pervading our campuses is the witch hunt mentality it fuels. It's more than dispiriting to find pro-sex student activists and queer-aligned students with lots of piercings and other insignias of nonconformity joining arms with administrators to rid the campus of supposed malfeasance, and incredibly historically short-sighted, to say the least, given how many of the witches being hunted somehow turn out to be queer, or merely suspected of being queer. The resulting accusations often sound absurd, yet they derail people's lives, can wreck careers, and imperil livelihood. A woman professor I met while visiting another campus revealed that she'd been brought up on complaints for making suspicious eye contact with two female grad students and staring at one's chest and whispering in their ears. It so happened that the whispering took place in a library, her field was library science. She told this story in a bitterly funny way, or funnily bitter way, but it was probably not so funny at the time. She was summoned to a three-hour meeting, not told what the charges were or who had complained, not allowed to so much set foot on campus for 2 months while the case was in progress. In other words, she was treated like a sex offender, ordered to stay away from playgrounds. Perhaps you're thinking she was one of those lesbian predators who prowl academia in search of luscious young prey. Perhaps her students were thinking so too. She does have short hair and an authoritative bearing, but is as straight as they come, at least according to her. I didn't ask, she volunteered this information. And I've probably heard from at least 50 accused professors and graduate students subject to similar treatment on a variety of trumped up charges. It's worth noting that for all the talk about sex positivity on American campuses, the boundaries of sexual propriety are as rigid as ever. They just happen to be different boundaries. On the one hand, all sorts of practices and identities not long ago regarded as outre, transgenderism, polyamory, BDSM, have been recoded as virtues, lauded by sex positive students and all the hippest faculty. On the other hand, practices that were not long ago the norm have been recoded as criminal enterprises, consensual professor-student relationships, for instance. There's no less policing of identities and sexualities, it's just different identities and sexualities being favored and different ones demoted. Whenever I want to cause my supposedly sexually with it students a world of despair, I like to bring up Freud. If we didn't desire to have sex with our parents or vice versa, why would we need a taboo? I've been known to innocently inquire when a discussion turns to, say, family dynamics, or they tell me Freud is passé. Their faces fall, there are audible cries of alarm and disgust. Doesn't everyone dream about having sex with their parents once in a while? I once asked, trying to explain the Freudian concept of dreams as a playground for repressed wishes. I nearly got ejected from my own classroom. Without repression, what would stop us from going around having sex with anyone in sight, or including our siblings and maybe the family dog, I go on. More cries of disgust from the class. I'm just trying to introduce them to the idea that we're all constituted by taboos and repressions that we're not entirely aware of. That's the human situation. We consent by virtue of being alive to some amount of unwanted sex. Other people's sexuality is encroaching, unwelcome, and gross, and it has a perpetually troubling way of seeping out and impinging on ours. I don't mean physically in this case, I mean psychologically and emotionally and unconsciously. Freud is also a useful thinker when it comes to the connections between desire and prohibition. Freud's general surmise, as everyone knows, was that children desire their parents, same-sex parent as well as opposite. Recall that Freud thought everyone starts out as bisexual. This desire undergoes social repression, neurosis ensues. Of course, it's an article of faith in our time that all such desires run strictly in the other direction. Old people desire young ones, not the other way around. Why is intergenerational sex the great taboo of the moment? With professor-student dating the hugest of the taboos, when not long ago it was no big thing. And it's not that I want to date students, by the way, I'm just curious. Curiosity that led students to march on me, because I'd been a bit mocking about this new hysteria and the new consensual relations code, which is why the rise of intellectual rigidity on campus concerns me. I've had some firsthand experience with it. Please understand that I'm not encouraging anyone to sleep with their parents or their teachers. Where Freud becomes useful, especially for my students, aspiring writers and directors, is as the patron saint of failed self-awareness, the great disruptor of self-certainty. That is, if you take seriously his dispatches about how little we actually know ourselves, especially when it comes to attractions and repulsions. If I can get a student to look at herself as a mystery, as a bundle of mixed motives and ambivalences, rather than a potential complainant or a survivor in waiting, I know for a fact the chances are better that she'll produce some original work. I also think she'll probably be a better citizen, or a less accusatory one anyway. Campuses used to be refuges for eccentricity. Now being offbeat can be your undoing. If campus culture has become a machinery for accusation production, it's also going to be a factory of conformity, intellectual and otherwise. That's the sour truth behind the rhetoric of vulnerability and the administrative overreach that fosters it, a net loss of freedom. Not just freedom of eye contact or sexual freedom, but also intellectual freedom for all of us. The historic mission of the university is being eroded right in front of us, and for my part, I think it's time to start protesting before that option disappears entirely.
I'm sure that you'll be willing to entertain some questions from the audience.
Yes, sure.
Do we have some?
Questions or complaints?
I hope this doesn't sound pragmatically inconsistent, but I wonder if you could say more about gag orders. I've only recently been aware of that sort of thing here, where people were told they're not allowed to tell anyone. They're under investigation.
Yep.
And when one person actually said at the end of the process, yay, the investigation is over, on Facebook, that led to another investigation. So.
People are terrified, and I've seen some of the warnings that get issued. One guy sent me a list of, these increasingly more or less hysterical injunctions not to speak about what was going on. I mean, including, well, you can speak to your minister or maybe your spouse. I mean, it was so specific. And, you know, I've got many, many emails from people who said, alluding to having been brought up in charges and saying, I can't speak about it. And then maybe they'll speak later, but then they're, you know, very terrified about what will happen to them. People have jobs. A guy who's a law professor who wrote to me about a case of false accusation, he was found innocent, still can't talk about it. Rumors are circulating around his campus. He's terrified. I wanted to use an anecdote about him in the book I just finished, and he's terrified that even years later this will come back to him and he'll be, you know, found guilty of retaliation. So, I mean, I'm waiting for someone, I think our friends from FIRE are here, to protest this as a First Amendment issue, particularly to the extent that it's being issued, you know, by emanating from the OCR. So, but I mean, it's a reality. I mean, I don't know, and I haven't heard, and one of the problems with this story is, you know, it's impossible to investigate because it's all secret. So it's all being done with this impunity, but, you know, I'm waiting for somebody to challenge this. And I guess what happened in my case is I did challenge it. I could have been brought up on retaliation charges. I didn't think they would do it. So I sort of took the risk, and because I'm tenured, and in my case, going public was a kind of insurance policy, you know, but I think other people don't see it that way.
Even if your response to an accusation does not name your accuser, it is still considered to be retaliation against that accuser?
See, but this becomes part of the issue with the codes are being made up. I mean, I, in the essay that I wrote, did not name any parties and was still brought up on retaliation charges by somebody I alluded to. I had written 7 words about, and I was charged with retaliation. No, there were no names. So the problem with the... It's very uncertain to me whether any Title IX complaint that is brought to like an administrator has to be investigated. I was sort of told, it was implied to me that has to be the case, that they do. Northwestern said to me they did have to investigate.
That's true.
But what that means is anybody in practice can expand what Title IX covers ad hoc, you know, on their own, because that's what happened in my case. The complaint is decided the Title IX will cover an essay, you know, and the university treated that as though that was a legitimate complaint.
I had a Title IX investigation from a student who complained that because when examining rape in a course I was teaching, I used Susan Brownmiller's book, which is hardly a book about rape denial.
Right, yeah.
And the student's claim was this book is too dated. We should have been given something more recent, and therefore her rights as a female student were being violated.
I've heard other situations like that where, you know, senior professors, tenured professors have people complaining about the readings they've assigned, and particularly on issues of gender, like it has the wrong version of, say, gender differences in relation to aggression. That was like a complaint, and, you know, that went forward. So yeah, I've definitely heard of those. And it's a real academic freedom issue, and I'm glad the AAUP is finally coming out with, you know, recommendations.
No, I think that's very important. We have not yet seen the final version of that AAUP report.
Right. Yeah, I guess
the committee,
right.
What we had was a draft, and they wanted feedback until April 15th and would then assimilate that feedback to... I just hope they don't let it get watered down because they have some protests from the usual quarters.
There's a protest letter circulating by a group calling itself the Faculty Against Rape, where they say that my case, that I've misrepresented what the charges were, that it was actually about factual errors. There's this backpedaling of the complainants on my case. And my boyfriend said, are the faculty reform rape? So, I mean, anyway, that's the part of the protest that's against the AAUP report. Sorry, go ahead.
Yeah, I wonder if you can say something more about, and thank you, by the way.
Oh, thank you.
If you can say something about risk and publicness, because I think it's really interesting the way in which sort of like various mechanisms of discourses get played into this, right? And I mean, you're talking about the precarity of certain faculty not being able to speak out, right? So I wonder, like I'm thinking within the classroom, what kinds of materials, dated or not, I mean that's irrelevant, but that lead towards sort of critiquing or leads towards some kind of acknowledgement that mobilization can happen with precarious faculty or with tenured faculty. What is your sense of like a mobilizing effort amongst faculty to take a position that is not so, you know, danger Saxon or?
I mean, there has to be, and I think, you know, slowly it will build up, but I think at the moment, you know, people, I mean, as you know, I'm sure like something like half the professorate now are not in tenured lines. So there's that. And I think the other side is people don't want to be caught up in scandals and dragged through social media and be tweeted about and that kind of thing. I mean, I've already kind of made this book that I've just finished. I mean, I've already decided I'm not going within a mile of Twitter. You know, and it's because it's just like you don't need that much of whatever, you know, hostility directed at you if you try to speak out on an issue. But I mean, I've been told, I was talking to somebody who's on the faculty, the law faculty at Harvard, I'm sure people have heard this stuff, like, you know, law students are protesting faculty teaching courses that talk about rape. I'm surprised you were able to teach a course on rape. So, and I think
well,
people
women and gender studies wanted nothing to
yeah.
do about it.
But I think people are really folding. And I mean, in ways that I can understand, because it is, I mean, you know, I can kind of make light at this point about going through this process, but it, you know, it was pretty distracting, to say the least, at the time. I'm not sure if I'm totally answering your question, though.
No, you have. I mean, it's not something that you can answer necessarily, you know, immediately. It's just sort of like brainstorming, what are the other ways? Because I think there's a lot of there's a lot of energy being placed on redirection of policy, which I agree is, mm-hmm. is relevant. But I also think there's other stuff that needs to be going on to parallel the kind of like student activism that you're talking about.
Yeah.
I think there needs to be that kind of more local faculty activism that is not necessarily
yeah.
relying on policy, but is interested in looking at it from different perspectives, i.e. what gets taught in the classroom, not necessarily a course on sexual assault, but material that lends itself to being more critical about, you know, the messy stuff of sex.
The University of Chicago has been really out in front. Jeff Stone, who's in the law school, and they just came up with like a ramped up, a revised version of they already had a very good free speech code, and I think it's on the FIRE website that they've got a new academic freedom free speech code. And I think University of Virginia has also come up with one. So people send me these things. So I think at the faculty level, at the Senate level, that's, and I think the places, I mean, that's a way to go. And I think places that have faculty unions, which would be more state schools than private schools, or public schools anyway, I think have been better at trying to push back on some of this stuff. Because I know I was at Florida State, and they had actually pushed back against the imposition of a faculty-student dating ban, the kind that went into effect at my university. And I was kind of surprised at that. So I think there are these places where faculty do get together and have some voice.
If I could add a little bit to what Laura just said, one of the reasons that university administrations are so fond of cutting back tenure track positions and replacing them with these contingent or adjunct positions is not merely to save money, but also precisely because they know how precarious people in these insecure positions are, and thus how hesitant to assert themselves. So it's really something that's gone pari passu with the exponential explosion of the size of various segments of administration, Title IX bureaucracies being only one of many. My own department has gone down from 25 tenure track screen positions to 15. And the College of Liberal Arts generally is reducing its number of positions by about 20%. And a lot of these people are, however, being replaced with short-term contingent faculty who can be fired at a whim and who, of course, will never dare to speak up for good reason.
Speaking up, though, I mean, one of the things that I've become aware of is that if people are accused of things, and even when they're false accusations, provably false, if they're on renewable contracts, they're often not renewed or dumped like in year three of a five-year contract, as somebody just wrote me, it happened to him. What's also happening in these situations about faculty-student dating is that the timeline is bent. So he had briefly like had a flirtation with a woman who wasn't enrolled at the time, and then later enrolled in became a student in his department and said there had been a kiss before she was enrolled that was unwanted. And he was found, you know, not culpable, and still lost his job. So that, I think, is happening over and over, that if there's any whiff of anything, even when it's found not, you know, guilty, that people's contracts are not renewed. And that's the reality. I mean, when I say there's a war on professors, I mean, I really don't think that's hyperbole.
I mean, when you're on a contingent contract, you really have no legal right.
Yeah.
They can always come up with another excuse for why they didn't renew you. I saw a number of other hands here. Yes?
Thank you for your talk. So, one thing that you brought up that I think seems really true is that it's kind of a weird thing, right, that student activists would be finding allies in the administration, especially as far as I understand the story of the Title IX complaints, were originally directed against really bad administrators covering things up. And so, you know, I mean, thinking back to my own kind of activist days, there were always, as an undergrad, there were always alliances with the professors, right? And I just wanted to ask if we could think more about this not being sort of a war about students who are feminist in the wrong way, or, you know, being against the professors, and thinking more about how, you know, we as teachers can help to teach undergrads to think about these political issues. I mean, obviously there's a problem if you can't teach certain classes or something like that, but it does kind of seem like there's the potential to have a lot more in common with the student activists in terms of, you know, a big critique of patriarchy or of the corporate university. So a big question, but I just wanted to ask if you can talk a bit more about creating some kind of alliances with students.
I mean, I think that there are alliances between some segments of the faculty and some versions of student activists, but I mean, there's another thing that's happening, which I think that the faculty have become more like, I mean, there's like a triangulation where it's the students and administrators sort of against the faculty. I mean, I was kind of shocked, you know, I make a sort of joke about it in the book, but when these students marched against me on campus, the like dean of students, the faculty, you know, these administrators, there were like three or four administrators that came out and were sort of aligned with the students, I mean, against a faculty member. So, you know, there's a lot of whatever discussion about the student as consumer, and partly this increase in administration is this kind of ramp up in student services and sort of servicing the consumer, the student consumer. So, I mean, it would be, I agree with you about that, and I think my own impetus is toward, you know, toward education, but in a way all the dollars are going toward administration and policing. So there's, you know, and away from, say, like faculty security or educational resources. So, you know, there, I like what you say, but I think there's a reality that the faculty are being shut out of these policymaking decisions and, you know, are, and are like the most, the minor players in this sort of equation.
Yes?
I was wondering if you could, since you had some conversations by email with those people who were brought up on sexual assault charges, Title IX, I was wondering, it seems very mysterious, like the process of like the investigation process. I was wondering if you have any like quick insights about what actually happens, like what goes on? Is there a courtroom? Like in my mind, I just feel like there's some kind of courtroom, but it's probably not like that.
Well, one of the things, you know, I got sent a lot of interesting documents. One of the things I got sent, which was fascinating to me, was somebody who was kind of a disaffected Title IX officer sent me like a chat room discussion between a bunch of Title IX officers where they're talking about what types of procedures to use in these settings, you know, which are usually just in some kind of conference room, let's say. I mean, this is different than the student tribunals, because that's a different situation. So I'm familiar with the faculty tribunals. And I don't think they're codified by the DOE or the OCR. I think they're actually invented, each campus invents their own set of procedures, I think oftentimes in an ad hoc way. So what I mostly have heard is, and this was confirmed about this chat room discussion by these Title IX people, they want to withhold telling the person complained about, the respondent, what the charges are. So a typical procedure is someone will get a letter or, you know, email summoning them to a meeting, not being told, you know, that there's been a complaint, not being told the nature of the charges. I mean, this was true in my case too. Not being told the charges, being asked a lot of questions, oftentimes fishing expedition type questions, sometimes not being told who the complainants are, So, you know, the Title IX officers or whoever is doing the investigation are wanting to strategically withhold information to get people to, you know, because they feel like if the people know what they're being charged with, then they will be less honest, let's say. But what was in this discussion, which I found kind of horrifying, was they were saying, well, I want to watch the person's face while I tell them the charges and then judge whether, you know, they're guilty or innocent. So, I mean, this is the kind of procedure, you want to talk about proceduralism, they're using specious kinds of, like, whatever, you know, sense, I don't know if it's instinct or they've read some book about body language or something, to decide by facial expression whether this person is, you know, telling the truth or not. So, I mean, as Tom was saying, I mean, it's an inquisitorial model rather than an adversarial one. So there's like an appointment. I mean, they act as an inquisitor. They collect information. Sometimes they will interview other witnesses and, you know, supposedly weigh the two versions of the story against each other and then decide which one they believe is true. But oftentimes not really doing any particularly sufficient kind of investigation. But, I mean, so that's a... I've heard just this a lot, is like not being told what the charges are, so that you don't have a chance to respond to the charges also, you know, by people who are accused. And, you know, one thing I should say is most...
Or to prepare for your interview with these people.
I mean, sometimes you'll be summoned to a meeting and it turns out it's something else, or codes are being applied, like a different year's code, like somebody dates a former student in 2009, you know, or let's say 2012 maybe, and there wasn't a code against it at the time. You go to a meeting and the adjudicator has, investigator has this year's code, which says it's not, you know, allowed. So no, it's incredibly unprocedural. But it varies from campus to campus in terms of, like in our campus, the procedures are sort of in the faculty handbook. Well, actually that's not true. Let me take that. That's not true.
I mean, you should ask this question of LaToya Hill Smith, who I don't think is here tonight, but she will be in the last panel tomorrow. I mean, she's the one in charge of the hearing. And frankly, I want to learn more about, you know, just what the procedures are now.
I mean, I wish people would go public more, but as I say, they're scared to do that.
Yes?
So you said that this culture is evidence that feminism is broken, and isn't choice, and in this case, the choice to engage in sexual activity, the foundation of feminism?
Oh, yeah, for sure. I mean, I would agree with that. You know, one of the things that I have discovered is that somebody makes a choice at the time, or, you know, makes what seems like a choice anyway. I mean, you know, as I say, given how much alcohol is often being consumed, it's sometimes hard to say what a choice is, but somebody makes a choice and then withdraws their consent retroactively. So a choice that was made freely, somebody later says, I didn't make that choice, and presses charges. I mean, you know, I have no idea what percentage of the time that is. But no, I'm certainly, in any case where there's physical force being used, I say that is sexual assault or that is, you know, rape. I mean, I think rape is forcible penetration. I think sexual assault is the use of force to force someone into sex. I mean, what's happening in these statistics gathering missions is, you know, something like somebody touching you at a party in a way you don't like being reported as sexual assault. So, you know, and I mean, that's not good. Nobody wants to be touched at a party in a way they don't want, but it's not sexual assault. It's like an annoying thing, I think. So, you know, I think there's just this expansion of, you know, kind of overcharging, I guess. I mean, does that kind of answer what you're asking? Do you think that I'm missing something?
That's about it, yeah.
Yeah, but I mean, yeah, sure, absolutely choice. One of the issues that I have gotten talking to students is that I feel like women students, in a way, don't often know what they want. So in a, where it comes to making a decision, people aren't making a decision because they don't exactly know what they want. And I think, and this is a, I don't want to embark on gender stereotypes, but in those situations, it seems oftentimes like guys know what they want. The woman doesn't know what she wants. So she gets persuaded, or she goes along with it, or whatever, and then maybe later has regrets, or maybe later thinks, oh, well, whatever. But so it's like more discussion about that, you know, moment. How do you think about what you want in that moment? And I feel like in this focus on punishment, there's not a focus on that moment of, well, how do you know what you want, you know?
Yeah, Deb Davis, who's a forensic psychologist, is going to be talking about this kind of thing and how people remember, you know, these often very ambivalent, you know, moments. And we're going to be hearing about some of that tomorrow. Are there any final questions? Yes, Chandra.
So you raised some problems with this sort of believe survivors movement. Mm-hmm. And I think that movement comes in part because of, and I think Thomas mentioned this, that survivors of sexual assault have often been silenced. And so how is it that we cope with that without swinging to the other side of the pendulum, especially given the specifics of when and where sexual assault and rape happen? For instance, almost always between, or not fair to say that, but between just the victim and the perpetrator, or this mm-hmm. is the victim, this is the victim.
Yeah. I mean, this sounds horrible to say, but I kind of just do think that there's an inflation of who gets called a survivor. And I am sort of for a little more discussion about what do we mean by rape, what do we mean by sexual assault. And if people who've been raped, or I'm going to confine it to rape, if people who've been raped would like to call themselves survivors and speak out, I mean, I see, you know, that seems great to me. I'm all for that, and people should talk about their experiences, and it should be de-shamed, and it should, you know, and also strategies for how to deal with those situations. I mean, not just after the fact, but at the moment. You know, I'm like really in favor of, I think there should be mandatory self-defense training for women. I took self-defense training when I was in my 20s, and it was like incredibly mind-altering, you know, to like fight off a guy, one of those guys in padded suits, and yell no. And I mean, I just think that could really like alter the sort of conditions of femininity. The kind of, so, you know, I'm interested in like creative or solutions like that. And you know, so I don't see any kind of what's the word, contradiction in what I'm saying and our survivors movement, but I think that there's an inflation of the category of survivor to include things like, you know, a bad date, let's say, you know. And I'm not trying to take the Katie Royfe line. I mean, I think that there are problems with that analysis, the hers in the morning after.
Anything else? Yes.
Hi, so I just had a question about, at one point you were talking about the Cleary Act, mm-hmm. And you indicated that there is, that the Cleary Act has not, that you cited some studies that indicated that the Cleary Act has not been effective,
it was that the sexual assault, ways of reducing sexual assault have not been effective.
Right. So, yep. So
and we know the statistics because of
the Cleary Act is about statistic gathering. Yeah.
Right. So the Cleary Act is about statistics, but right. But you were talking about it in terms of prevention education, correct?
No, I was saying that the reporting started with the Cleary Act, and that I was citing a study, which is like a meta study of 69, like other studies about whether sexual assault training on campuses has had any effect on reducing levels of sexual assault, and the results have been no.
Right. So,
according to this study.
So the thing that I just wanted to mention is that the Cleary Act has actually added, or the Violence Against Women Act of 2013
added reported
prevention education as a requirement. But it didn't. It wasn't in there as of 1992, which was the year that you mentioned. And so those meta studies haven't had time to really assess what has happened as a result of prevention education being required on college campuses. Because the Violence Against Women Act, the regulations that require comprehensive prevention education didn't go into effect until October of 2014. So it's, we haven't had time to assess what the result is of those prevention programs, because most schools, in fact, didn't put them in place until after the effectiveness of the statute. So,
well, there has been measurements, because as I say, this study that I'm citing cites 69 other studies. So the timeline, I think we're talking about different timelines here, but the point that I was making in bringing up this meta-study was that the style of sexual assault prevention training that seems to be more demonstrably effective is the one less favored in these mandatory sexual assault training programs on campus. So that was the point that I was making. So not about the timeline. But as I'm saying, the measurements, I mean, it is being measured. So I think to say it started in 2014, I mean, that may be true as far as the Violence Against Women Act and the mandatory assault training, but they have been measuring the effect of assault prevention training for a longer period.
Yes, that's true. The only thing that I wanted to make clear was that the risk. So you were saying that was in the part of your speech where you were talking about how the primary prevention folks do not like to talk about risk reduction,
right,
because they are concerned that will look like victim blaming.
Yes.
But the Cleary Act actually takes a comprehensive prevention approach and explicitly has risk reduction in the language of the statute. So the prevention education that's happening on college campuses is not necessarily, is not necessarily not using risk reduction techniques or shying away from those and just doing primary prevention. I just wanted to sort of probe on that and find out where you were getting that from.
I don't have the citations in this paper. I do have citations, which if you want to give me your email, I will send you those citations. But all those quotes that I read from people running these sexual assault programs speak directly to this and say that the focus should be on training men not to assault. So, I mean, people are saying different things, I guess, than you're saying in terms of whether there's what strategies they're using.
Okay, one final question.
Well, it's more of a comment. But, I'm a social psychologist, and we study social influence. Maybe there's some social psychologists in the room, I don't know, but our primary finding is that, people do what they think other people are doing. And if you normalize something, people are more likely to do it. So, for example, alcohol prevention programs, when you go around telling kids, so many, huge percentage of kids drink on campus, that makes them more likely to drink, not less likely to drink. And now we're telling everybody's raping everybody else, and that's normalizes rape. You would expect a lot of the kinds of sexual assault prevention programs that go on to actually increase rape. We've had one on our campus for years and years, and a primary statistic offered in that course is that, this idea that one quarter of women are going to get raped, and that most men, if they say, if you ask them, if you knew you could get away with it, would you rape somebody? Most men say they would. And that is presented as part of these sexual assault prevention programs. as a social psychologist, I would say you don't do that, because we know that that makes people more likely to do things, not less, if you tell them lots of people are doing it. So, you know, it's really important to test these things before you deploy them, and people are not testing these things before they deploy them. And lots of interventions backfire, not just these kinds of things, but lots of interventions backfire that seem to make perfect sense. And it's really just not smart to go deploy things in the field that you haven't tested to see if they work or don't work.
I mean, I think that what's happened is that partly what you're saying, this knowledge that the 1 in 5, you know, that statistic getting thrown around, it makes things that were would not have been called rape, you know, 5 years ago or 10 years ago, be defined as rape, and accusations being brought about experiences that was what I'm calling stupid sex. So I think there's this criminalization of this kind of area of, you know, not great sex, sex you wish you didn't have, you know, but then now is resulting in official charges being brought, partly because of the way that statistic is being deployed, or the language of survivors, the language of, you know, rape culture is being deployed.
Yeah.